Make the call to order the Tuesday, December 19th, 2017. Sheboygan County Board of Supervisors meeting. Certification of compliance with the open meeting law.
The agenda was posted on the 15th of December at 2 p.m.
Thank you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call.
Two supervisors present.
Thank you. Approval of the November 7th, 2017 journal. Supervisor Winkle.
Move to approve.
Thank you, Supervisor Winkle. Supervisor Koch.
Second.
Thank you, Supervisor Koch. Any questions or discussion? All those in favor, vote aye. Opposed, nay.
Motion's approved unanimously.
Okay, consideration of appointments by the chairperson.
To the Monarch Library System, a reappointment, William Gehring, and to the Veterans Service Commission, a reappointment, Jennifer Sampson.
Supervisor Epping.
Thank you, Chairman. Motion to approve both of these appointments.
Thank you, Supervisor Epping. Supervisor Testrudi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Supervisor Testrudi. Any discussion? If not, please push your aye button or nay.
Those appointments are approved unanimously.
Thank you. Presentations.
We have none.
Public addresses.
There was one with the Roger Hollingstead, but he called and couldn't make it tonight.
Thank you. Letters, communications, and announcements.
We have none.
Thank you. County Administrator's Report. Adam?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
Well, we should be out of here relatively soon, I think. I hope too many of you weren't disappointed when he said Administrator's Report and John didn't respond, there is none. I have four topics I wanted to touch on briefly. One, as you are aware, if you reviewed the email that I sent out, I think yesterday, in response to our friend Supervisor Jim Baumgart, Chairman Wagner and I did have an opportunity to testify in support of Senate Bill 466 and Assembly Bill 588. And as you know, this has been a topic of discussion in our community for years. The EPA has regulations in place that are very important to protect air quality for our constituents, our family and friends, and what the EPA does and the Department of Natural Resources does is very important. However, we have a monitoring station right on the shore of Lake Michigan that is capturing predominantly emissions or pollution from other areas outside of Sheboygan County, from Indiana, Chicago, Illinois. So, the chamber and our local businesses have been working for some time with Sheboygan County, other local units of government, as well as the Department of Natural Resources to see what can be done to address the problem that the EPA is utilizing this monitoring station to put regulations here in place that our citizens and businesses are subject to that is really punitive and unfair, because they're relying on air quality data, again, measuring pollution and emissions from other areas outside of Sheboygan County. So to the credit of the county board, Working in collaboration with the DNR and the chamber, we established a second monitoring station in Haven, which is on county property by one of our highway sheds in 2014, to start capturing data from the emissions of our actual local businesses, and what we're producing here. And now after 3 years of data, it's been determined that we are meeting EPA regulations, at least to the extent where we wouldn't need this more burdensome or heavy regulation that, again, is not only punitive to the citizens and local businesses here, but really can have an impact for a business choosing to expand or families to move here and work in this community. So Senator Devin Lemieux, as well as our other local area legislators, legislation for the DNR to say, rather than collecting the data from this station, we should be collecting it from the Haven station and sharing that with the EPA. The EPA should be relying on that. And ultimately, this may be more about music than actual action, because the EPA needs to listen, and to date they have not, and it will be the EPA's decision on which monitoring station they ultimately choose to continue to use. So Chairman Wagner and I, Mayor Vandersteen, and other community leaders weighed in and expressed our support for this. There is an accompanying bill that I think Senator Strobel has authored, and I'm pretty certain that's the bill that Jim Baumgart was alluding to, where Senator Strobel was looking for the DNR to really roll back all sorts of regulation that's been put in place for our citizens' best interest by the State Department of Natural Resources. And it was looking in one swipe to eliminate a lot of this regulation, and any regulation the DNR would put in after 10 years would just automatically expire. You know, imagine a situation where rules you put in place or other good governance that's in place, whether it's speeding limits, what have you, are just gone. And you need to revisit and start from scratch without anything in play. Obviously, that can be problematic. So I don't know if that legislation is going to have legs or not. Personally, Chairman Wagner and I do not support that legislation, I think, and would rather rely on our state and our State Department of Natural Resources to put in protections for our citizens than the federal government. But that's a different piece of legislation. So just wanted to be clear on that if you didn't have a chance to look at that legislation. And then, of course, for our TVA viewers, and Edmund Feldner's here from the Plymouth Review, I think it's important to continue to make sure that the community is aware that this is an unfair, punitive regulation that the EPA hangs their hat on because of pollution from other states. And as the DNR has concluded, even if all of our local businesses completely eliminated any emissions, it would not impact the Kohler-Andre monitoring station enough to reduce the current level of regulation that the EPA is requiring. So it really boils down to good science and common sense to make a change there. Second thing I wanted to touch on was, again, something that Sherman Wagner and I recently had the privilege of participating in, and it wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for the county board. Last year, in 2016, as you know, under the leadership of Ed Stengel and many others, predominantly at our Health and Human Services Department, the county established a drug and alcohol treatment court. And this is an initiative that we need to do more of. Rather than people sitting in our detention center, not getting the help they need to get back on the right path, get back with their families, be contributing members of the community, rather than sitting in the detention center and just not getting help, individuals that meet certain criteria are getting all sorts of support from our judicial branch, our Health and Human Services Department, law enforcement. It's an incredible collaborative effort to help people. People who have made mistakes would certainly deserve a second chance. And so Ed Stengel reached out to Chairman Wagner and I, and Tom had a chance to say a few words to the group, but they had their first graduation. Was that was last
Friday.
It was Friday, last week Friday.
Days go
fast. The older I get, the more I lose track of time. Last week Friday, and I can't tell you how heartwarming it was to sit there and see the first graduate after a year going through this process. I mean, there's a lot of involvement and responsibility that those individuals need to take to be successful. To see that play out where this person with their child, and I don't know if it was a wife or significant other in the courtroom, going to be able to be reconvened with their family, and then the individual spoke to the judge and everyone involved and thanked everyone in the county, including the county board, for the support to get this program going. So if you ever get a chance to sit in on one of these court proceedings and see how they interact with the clients and get a feel for the different resources that are pulled together, I encourage you to do it, because it really, I think, reflects so well on Sheboygan County for providing us. And if you see Ed Stangle, which certainly you see Judge Stangle at our legislative breakfasts and occasionally other forums, please thank him, because he does an excellent job. The third thing I wanted to touch on, as I have every board meeting for quite some time now, is the transportation complex update. So if Chris Galinsky could power that up for me. We're about 75% done. We continue to make good progress. The staff from Elkhart Lake and Plymouth sheds are poised to move in either year end, which obviously is within the next couple of weeks, or as Greg Chanel shared with me today, it might be the first or second week in January, because they obviously are working hard to make that happen. But the final facility will be completed in April. Next slide. So what's happened? We were so blessed with some good weather up through December 1st. I think deer hunting weekend was miserable, but the week thereafter, really, we had some nice weather, and our excellent highway department crew not only did over 31 miles of paving this year, which they take a lot of pride in, as they should, but they got all the paving done around the transportation complex, and obviously that's nice for maintaining it the winter and plowing and people coming and going. So they were able to get that all done by December 1st. Next slide. Here's an aerial. This was taken before, obviously, they completed all of it, but you can see the paving in the back is quite a bit that surrounds our footprint there. And again, our workforce did it, and they did an excellent job. And we're just so thankful that the weather held out just long enough for them to be able to get in there and do so. Just to get you orientated, that's the salt shed that's right in the foreground there. The building right in front of that is the cold storage facility, and then of course the large building in the background is the main head transportation complex. Next slide. Another shot of it there, you can see the fuel area right to the in front of the building, and again it's all now in beautiful asphalt and looking good. Next slide. The cold storage, if you drive by now, you'll see them starting to work on that and getting the walls going up, so that's in play. Next slide. This is a beautiful training area for our staff, as well as it's going to serve as an emergency operations center. And not a lot of people may recall that or have thought about that. You know, you think about this transportation complex and the importance of it and the investment it is for our community. But there was enough foresight that went into this building and the plans and the location that Steve Steinhardt, our emergency management director, and others have worked together to make sure that this room has all the capability that in the situation where we have a real emergency, or we lose one of our main facilities, this is a place that emergency responders, leaders can convene when there's a real crisis. So that's going to be a dual opportunity there for use of the facility. Next slide. This is the main parking area, and the picture really doesn't do it justice, because for those of you who have been in it, and a number of you have, it is immense. It is a large room, but what's different today than the last time you were in there, it is now painted. Next slide. Over 20,000 gallons of paint are going into this complex. So a lot of people have been working hard on getting the paint done. Next slide. And to help them out, we convened our department heads, and you can see those buckets in front of us there, and we all pulled together, and we had a department heads meeting out there a week or so ago and toured the facility along with former Chairman Roger Distrudy and Mark Winkles there, and I know Chairman Wagner went through it, I think, the week earlier when we had a meeting out there, but most of our department heads had a chance to come many of them for the first time, and as you can see, we look really good in those outfits. Next slide. This is the locker room. The staff of our facility are going to have a very nice locker room. Next slide. This is the salt shed. Greg just ordered all the salt. I guess that holds, what, 5,000 pounds of salt in this facility alone? Thank you, Mark. Say that again.
Tons.
5,000 tons. Thank you. 5,000 tons of salt in that facility alone. What did he share with me? That we ordered 12 tons, 5,000 tons go in the new complex site, and it's selling for about $72 a ton, which is, depending on your perspective, maybe not too bad. We've paid more, but we've also paid less. Hopefully we're not going to have to be using too much of that too soon, although it sounds like we've got weather coming Thursday, Friday. So 75% complete. Elkhart and Plymouth staff are going to be looking to move in within the next few weeks, and we'll have it done in April, and so far, so good. Next slide. Wanted to end on the budget, and I shared this snapshot before, but it really is a credit to Greg and Jim TeBeast and just some good fortune. As you recall, we budgeted $24.8 million plus the $25 million for this facility. The bid process produced $1 million under budget, thanks to some competitive bidding, so that was good. We have a significant contingency because, of course, you always have change orders or things come up. And because of the good attention to the budget and how the building has been going up, the Finance Committee, the Transportation Committee agreed that we could reduce that contingency by $500,000. So the bonding resolution you have before you, and there was a memo from our finance director in your packet. We'll be looking for not obviously a motion to support that, which has already been, this bonding has already been supported as part of our budget process and the five-year capital planning process. But we're looking to reduce it by $500,000, again, because we're in good financial position with completing this transportation complex. So feeling good about that. Thank you, Chris. Finally, if Chairman Wagner and Vice Chairman Marthenzi could join me. We have two service award pins tonight. That's why there's so many people here this evening, family and friends, like Aaron Brault, Dave Lafine. If Aaron could please come forward, the highly coveted service award discussion. Good evening. Your wife and kids couldn't make it tonight? You didn't invite your parents, I bet, did you?
No. They watch it on TV. Okay.
Well, we'll muddle along the best we can. I'm very fond of Aaron, as I am all of our department heads, but Aaron started with us 10 years ago, and it's hard to believe that 10 years have passed. When he started, he was hired as the non-motorized transportation program coordinator. A relatively young, new position in our planning and conservation department. As you know, we were so fortunate to receive this $25 million grant, as did three other communities across the nation. And Aaron had a key role in implementing that and working with the community to come up with plans and projects and see it through. And shortly after working in that position, he was promoted to manager of that program. And shortly after that, we had an opening for director, and I asked him if he would serve as our interim planning and conservation director. He agreed, and he shined. And in 2011, Aaron was appointed our director of planning and conservation. And what I find incredibly remarkable about Aaron is young, hadn't been a planning and conservation director before, hadn't worked for a county of our size with roles and responsibilities that he and his staff have. And his track record as a planning and conservation director, I have to believe his track record is as good, if not better, than any of his peers in the state, if not the region. It is remarkable what Aaron has accomplished, obviously with the support of the PRACOM committee and the county board as a whole, but it is remarkable, just to name a few. Non-motorized transportation grant, as I mentioned, he took the lead in implementing that, not only as a staffer, but ultimately as a director. In total, it was a $28 million grant Sheboygan County. Actually received a little bit more than originally projected. The Sheboygan River and Harbor Dredging Project. Superfund site. One of the dirtiest, filthiest areas in the country. Black eye of the community. Aaron stepped right in, helped lead the charge to get people to come together from all walks of life, all different agencies. Ultimately, this community was able to capture over $100 million of resources to clean up the Sheboygan River and Harbor and dredge that filthy river and harbor. Aaron's leadership was just outstanding. Outstanding. In addition to that, he and his staff have been applying for brownfield grants to help with redevelopment areas, and they now have not only been more successful in that area than ever before, but it's led to about $25 million of redevelopment, thanks to Aaron's leadership, thanks to his staff. And then finally, and I sent an email just this afternoon about our Amsterdam Dunes Wetland Mitigation Bank and Preservation Area, you know, really two tremendous opportunities, one to preserve a beautiful area, and secondly, to create this mitigation bank that is in the works, again, under Aaron's leadership, so ultimately we can help with growth and development. Natural Resource Damage Assessment Grant is looking favorable, as I touched on, but Aaron also was able to successfully apply for what may be the largest state stewardship grant in history of the state, $2.4 million toward our preservation area. I doubt there are too many planning and conservation directors that can share that kind of track record. This is just four examples. So Aaron, I'm so proud that you work for Sheboygan County. I thank you for your 10 years of leadership. I thank you for the team that you've put together, the beautiful family that you're raising. You might get to see his son and daughter from time to time. I see him at the YMCA. Aaron and his wife Jenny, they're just good people, and he's making good things happen. So please join Chairman Wagner and Vice Chairman Martensi and I in thanking Aaron and recognizing him for 10 consecutive years of service to the people of Sheboygan County. Well done. Dave Lafine, please come forward. Thirty years of service to the people of Sheboygan County. Dave and I didn't spend as much time together during our tenure here. I've been here going on with 19 years, and we haven't spent as much time together as Aaron and I have. And part of he's the coroner, you know? But I tell you, every time we'd sit down and talk, and it always happens during the budget development process, but occasionally in other instances, he is one of the most sincere, down-to-earth, genuine people you will ever meet. And the work that he does, it's fascinating what he does. You know, I think largely we take it for granted. We take it for granted because, one, he's very good at what he does. Two, he's been doing it for 30 years. But it's just one of those areas that, yeah, someone takes care of that type of important work. In 1987, he was elected coroner. And, of course, his mission is to help families and loved ones, whether it's a death investigation, whether it's signing a cremation permit, whether, sadly, it's an autopsy. He is working with people at a very difficult time. It's challenging work. And much of the work he does follows state statute, things that he has to do and needs to do. And I can't imagine many of us would want to do that kind of work. It takes a special person. He has four part-time deputies. Of course, Dave has built his team, and he's starting to think about how much longer he may want to do this type of work. But in 2015, in great part because of Dave's own advocacy, the county board changed his position from an elected coroner position to an appointed medical director, medical examiner. And Dave really advocated for it. And that was interesting because, you know, when you're talking about a change like that, that can create some angst or, is that really the right thing to do? But Dave felt, you know, he's got a strong medical background. The work he does requires a medical background. He wanted to retire, that we could hire the most qualified person with a medical background to continue the important work that he and his staff do. So he personally helped lead that charge with the law committee and with myself and the county board. Ultimately, the board made the change, and we were fortunate that he stayed to help with the transition. And who among us noticed any difference whatsoever? Totally a smooth transition. Handled it beautifully. And now when Dave does decide to retire, and we're in no hurry, but when he does, we're going to be in position to recruit and hire the most qualified person we can in the position. So I know Dave has told myself and others that he takes a lot of pride in helping with that change. I certainly appreciate his leadership and support with that. And I encourage you, if you haven't taken the time to talk to our former coroner and current medical examiner, to do so sometime. It may not necessarily be someone we're hoping shows up at our front door, but he is a very, very good man who does incredible work, and we can't thank you enough. Thank you for 30 years of service. I hope everyone has a very Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday.
Thank you, Adam. Next, I'd ask if we have consideration of committee reports, executive committee, resolution number 19.
Regarding authorizing the issuance and sale of $7.18 million of general obligation promissory notes.
Right, and I'm going to ask Brad Bigot from our bond council from Baird to come up first and explain it before we get it on. You don't mind?
Thank you. Brad Bigot with Baird, who's serving as underwriter for the issuance of this obligation. I'll walk through a presentation packet that was distributed just prior to this meeting, and it was taken up at an earlier meeting of the executive committee this evening. The finance committee. The first page after the cover provides a summary of the resolution you're considering this evening. By way of description, this is a general obligation promissory note, issue size of $6,680,000. That represents the $500,000 reduction in the bonding for this project that was authorized by the county board. The funds will close and be available to the county on January 10th of next year, and there's scheduled principal payments annually beginning May 1st of 2019, with the final payment of May 1st of 2027. First interest is budgeted for payment on May 1st of next year, and then interest payments will be semi-annually through 2027. There is a call feature, that is, the county has the ability to prepay this debt, either with the new financing or with funds available on hand. So the 2026 and 27 maturities can be prepaid at the county's option on May 1st, 2025, or any business day thereafter. I've outlined two ratings that are assigned. First, there's an issuer rating from Moody's Investor Service. Moody's was not asked to assign a rating to this specific transaction, but rather Moody's released an annual report that it provides for these types of ratings. It's an annual rating report. And Moody's assigned the AA2 rating for the county's debt. The complete rating report is attached from both of these. Just a few of the highlights I want to be sure to touch on both reports. First, Moody's starts under the credit overview section by describing Sheboygan County's credit position as very good. And they continue on in that paragraph to talk about a substantial tax base and healthy socioeconomic profile. All of the other factors cited in the Moody's report are also positive. By way of finances, they're calling the financial position of the county very strong. Debt and pensions are identified as extremely small. The economy and the tax base, very strong overall. And then the management and governance section follows. The second rating you'll see is from S&P Global, that's Standard & Poor's Global. Standard & Poor's was asked to assign a rating to this transaction. Standard & Poor's assigned a AA- rating, and this is the first time that Standard & Poor's has rated the county's debt. Their rating report is also attached. There's a very significant difference with their characterization of the economic condition of the county, where they're calling the economy of the county weak. I couldn't disagree more. Standard & Poor's is missing the mark in their characterization of the county's economic profile. It's really a flaw in their analysis, and that is that they look at the industry concentration, and if that concentration is above 30% in any industry, that puts a cap on puts an anchor on the county's rating. Well, the manufacturing concentration here in the county is just over 30%. Standard & Poor's methodology is very rigid, and it is not compromising. So, for example, they're not taking into consideration all of the, say, food-related manufacturing, medical equipment, and so on, things that are recession-proof, so to speak. And that's leading to this 30% concentration, which is leading to this mischaracterization of the county's economic condition. All of the other factors are very positive. And all of these other factors that Standard & Poor's evaluates are factors that you as elected officials and your county staff have direct control over influencing. So specifically, Standard & Poor's talks about strong management, good financial policies, your adequate budgetary performance, that's a recognition that you maintain a balanced budget, very strong budgetary flexibility. They talk about the solid fund balance of the county, very strong liquidity, strong debt and contingent liability position, and a strong institutional framework. So but for their misunderstanding, mischaracterization of the economy, the rest of this report is very, very positive. Overall, Baird was out in the marketplace this morning taking orders from investors. The initial interest rate that we had anticipated, the initial rates we went out with to the market, were at 2.42% for this obligation. We had such strong demand. There were so many investors that wanted to buy the county's debt and invest in the county. We were able to reduce that interest rate. And that reduced rate is reflected in your resolution. It's here in terms of summary. That rate is 2.39%. So you're getting a financing package here that's going to be paid off by 2027 below 2.4%. We remain in a very attractive interest rate environment, and when the county is taking on a project like this transportation complex and your other capital projects that this is financing, it's really a very good time to be in the market and to lock in rates at a very attractive levels. On the following page is a very detailed financing plan. I won't walk through this line by line, but I would point out that this plan was taken to finance, it was massaged, it was designed to meet the goals that the county needs to meet in allowing for potential future debt issuance. It doesn't commit to any future debt issues, but there's room to layer in borrowings if needed out into the future. And there's a downward movement in the debt repayments. So this plan, as it's presented here, meets all of the goals that were laid out by the Finance Committee prior to securing this debt. The last sections here have detailed rating reports that I've already referenced. I won't walk through those again line by line. I covered the high points on that. But I wanted to make sure that all of the county board received printed copies so that you have hard copies of those reports. So with that, I'd be glad to go into additional detail or answer questions.
Supervisor Urena.
Thank you, Chairman Wagner. I do have a few questions because I know the tax bill that's both in the House and the Senate will impact municipal bonds. One of the pieces in both legislation is to put an end to the advance refunding of municipal bonds. And will that not allow the prepayment situation?
It will not allow prepayment in advance of the call date. Once we're at the call date, the county can prepay either with other bonds or with other available funds.
So So in this case, the call date would be quite a few years in the future, correct?
Correct. And so when we look at the county's overall debt profile, that's why we make sure to have other debt issuances that have call features that are earlier to provide the flexibility the county may need.
So that legislation or that change in the tax law will not impact the previous bonds that we have outstanding?
It prohibits the issuance of tax-exempt debt to advance refund any other obligations.
I see.
So it doesn't change those call features, it just prohibits the county from issuing debt in advance of those call dates.
Okay.
On a tax-exempt
basis.
That would
be a pretty big change then, since we typically do prepay, and we did last year prepay, I think it was $3 million. And
right. The county still has the ability to issue taxable obligations to prepaid debt, and in fact, I just, with another issuer, entered into that type of an arrangement where taxable bonds were issued to advance refund tax exempt debt. So you're not locked from the market, you still have flexibility, not as much flexibility though that we had before the end of this year.
Okay. Thank you, and did you see any other, I've noticed there are a number of pieces relating to municipal bonds that are, that there's anticipated to be some impact on the demand. You see that impacting us? You're saying that right now there's a high demand, and that's what they're saying because of the fact that state mobile tax deductions in part will be reduced. There's a greater increase in the demand for municipalities and in high state areas. Is that something that's driving the demand, or is that more
general? Well, what's on your specific issue, what's driving the demand is your good, this is the name. It's the good credit quality of the county.
All right. I wasn't sure if it was related to some of the tax changes that are coming up.
No, that is not driving the demand for this.
Thank you.
Supervisor Epic.
Thank you very much. As you stated, your true interest cost is 2.39%. That was negotiated from what?
The initial was 2.42 this morning, 2.42. And then subsequent to that order period was reduced.
Yeah. I'm not much in the financials, but 2.42 to 2.39, it doesn't seem like to be that much of a substantial change, is it? I suppose on a large volume like we're doing, it's a substantial amount, right?
Yeah, it is. And you know, this type of market has a very sharp edge. So when we can see interest rate movements of less than 1/100th of a percentage point. And in this case, we're seeing a movement that's 3/100ths of a percentage point. So that's somewhat significant.
Okay. As a follow-up question to that, is the fact that S&P's rating was not as good as Moody's. Did that have any impact that we couldn't have gotten a better interest rating, less than 2.39?
Yeah, the Standard & Poor's rating coming in where it did, and probably had estimated impact of 0.05% or 5 basis points. So a small impact. In, to convert that to dollars, it's around $1,500 annually throughout the repayment period of these bonds, of these notes.
Okay, I was just disappointed that S&P didn't rate us as good as Moody's.
Right.
If we could have gotten a better rating.
I completely agree. Completely agree. S&P really missed the ball on the economic environment. And you're a county with 2.5% unemployment, that's essentially full employment from an economic standpoint. You've got a very solid tax base in manufacturing, sure, mm-hmm. but broader than that throughout the county, residential and commercial, and you're a very well-managed county. So I completely agree that Moody's did not get the rating, or I'm sorry, Standard & Poor's did not get the rating right.
How do we deal with that as far as letting investors know that they're off base?
Well, the Moody's report that came out one day before the Standard, or one day after that Standard & Poor's report, the investors in your debt have access to both of those reports, and they're reading both of those. So it's, they're disclosed out on dissemination websites, and there's notifications that are coming to the investors of your debt. They're getting these reports, and they can see from Moody's, they can see how strongly Moody's disagrees with Standard & Poor's analysis.
Okay, thank you very much for that explanation.
Sure.
Thank you, Supervisor Epping. Anything else for Brad? Thank you very much, Brad.
Okay,
then I'll go back to Supervisor Wegeman, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll move for adoption of resolution number 19.
Thank you, Supervisor Wegeman. And Supervisor Winkle?
I'll second what under our point of order. Supervisor Wegeman, is your motion to adopt as amended?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. This gets a little convoluted, so now I need a motion to adopt as amended before a vote. Supervisor Gehring?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll make that motion to adopt as amended to the new amount, the lower amount.
Thank you, Supervisor Gehring. Supervisor Wegeman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll second that motion.
Thank you, Supervisor Wegeman. On this we vote. Okay, now we're voting on to adopt as amended, which was a reduction.
No, you're voting on amending.
I'm being corrected here by Carl. Thank you, Carl. Everybody square, seeing as I wasn't.
So the deal is this. When the resolution first came out, it was for the $7 million borrowing. Your budget was adopted, knocking a half a million off, as indicated, because of the good work on the transportation complex. So when it was introduced, it was the $7 million. When it got to the executive committee, it was knocked down by the half million. So it is being introduced as amended out of the executive committee. However, when it came out of the executive committee, it had certain blanks in it because, as Brad indicated, until it actually comes out for solicitation, we can't fill in the blanks. The blanks were filled in at the meeting of the Finance Committee just before the board meeting tonight. So therefore, you need to vote on amending the Executive Committee's proposal, which amended the original finance. So you're voting first to amend per the Finance Committee's report incorporating the numbers that Brad provided this afternoon.
And you wonder why I got confused. I'm sorry. Thank you, Carl. Thank you, Carl. You're right. I know you're right. I know you're right. So everybody square, we're voting on this now at this point. Agree. So push your I button or nay button.
That motion is approved unanimously.
Okay, now I need another motion. Supervisor?
No more motions. All that's you need to is, upon the completion of the debate, take a vote.
We don't need motions.
You don't need any more motions.
There's discussion?
There's discussion, but
okay.
You don't need any more motions.
Yeah, I thought that's what you told me. I'm sorry, I misinterpreted. Okay, discussion then. Supervisor Hoffman.
Just a quick question. What is our total bonded indebtedness for the county, because I know here a while back we took out $10 million. That's still on my desk, so I'm just kind of curious. And I'm sure we're well within the limits, but I'm just wondering what we have out front.
I know at the leadership every year we talk about that.
Right.
We show that graph, and we're substantially below the limit. But I don't have that number offhand. I don't know, Wendy, do you have that available? Let me push your button here. All right. That was very innocent. Thank you, Wendy.
We're projecting, including this borrowing for ending 2018 to be at $36.8 million.
How much?
$36.8 million.
Okay, thank you. Supervisor Hoffman, I won't use that phrase again. Supervisor Ritter.
So I appreciate getting answers to some of the questions I had asked yesterday. I was thinking the same situation as Brian, where back in June we incurred a general obligation note for $10 million. That was on actually May 16th of this year, 17. April, May timeframe, that $10 million was noted as you know, for the capital improvement for the new transportation complex. And I, you know, see at this point, we're, you know, a good portion of this 10 million or $6.7 million is also for the transportation complex. And so both 10 and the 6 were basically the transportation complex, right? I guess that's the question.
Always directed towards me, and then I...
Okay, thank you.
Well, not, even if I don't have the answer, I find the person who does. So that was your question is?
So the $10 million we borrowed back in was for the transportation complex. And now this $10 million, or $6.7 million is also for the transportation complex. I'm a little confused why we've got both debts.
Why we did it over two borrowings. Wendy, you want to answer that, please?
Yes. The $10 million is for, it included the transportation complex, but it was for all of the 2017 five-year capital plan capital projects. And that is the same for the $6 million here. It is for the 2018, all the capital projects in the five-year plan for 2018.
So a combination. Thank you.
So then...
Oops. All right, go ahead.
So then, you know, I realize our self-imposed debt limit is $11 million per year. And I guess that $10 million was for...
I don't think that's right.
Not, it's not $11 million every 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
Self-imposed debt limit?
Right. You voted to go above the self-imposed debt limit, so there is no self-imposed debt limit as to these borrowings. You have resolutions in both the November cycle, budget cycle, and the year before, approving going over the self-imposed limit.
Okay, thank you. So for these last 2 years then, we've gone over our self-imposed limit and we've given ourselves approval to do so.
That's correct.
Go ahead.
Okay. So I'm thinking through this from the standpoint that we also just instituted the sales tax. I realize part of that will be used for roads because the budget for roads is $6 million and we're anticipating $9 to $10 million from the sales tax. So I guess I'm kind of struggling with the need for extra, and definitely was glad we're reducing it from the 10 to the 6.7, but I'm still trying to grasp my hands around with that added sales tax.
Faith, keep in mind on the sales tax that the roads are part of it, then we used $1 million for property tax reduction.
Yes.
And we used $1.5 million that we're sharing with, you know, so that ups that number, $2.5 million right there. Go ahead, Ann.
The 0.5% sales tax, as you know, is a separate matter because that's going to the roads and direct property tax relief. We're sharing it, separate matter from the bonding. You're bonding before you today. And we're fortunate to be able to reduce it from a little over $7 million to $6.6. That's good. And yes, it is more than the self-imposed, but that's because the board chose as part of the five-year capital plan and the budget adoption, which has already happened. We've already gone through and vetted this for months, as well as discussed it at the annual county board leadership forum. So this is really now just following through to complete our transportation complex, as well as the other projects that the board has already approved and voted on as part of the five-year capital plan and the budget. And both documents, by the way, are now have new bounds on them and are on your desk. But we adopted the budget and five-year capital plan in the fall winter already. So those decisions have already been made on what you're going to bond for.
Okay. Thank you. Supervisor Epic.
Thank you, Chairman Wagner. When Supervisor Uriner starts talking about all these figures and bond limits and whether or not we're behind or above or whatever, it is my understanding, and just to keep it simple for my own understanding, we initially had bond limits of $4 million over 2 years, correct?
Or was that each year.
Each year, over each year, right? So because we had these projects that we wanted to accomplish, accomplish, and because the market was at such a state that we could get money at a very reasonable rate, we increased our spending limits ourselves as a county board, right?
Correct.
And so at this point, is my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, we are still within our own self-imposed bond limits, but they're a little bit bigger than what initially we started out with. Is that correct?
I think you're right. You just shed some light on the subject. So thank you. Thank you. Adam, you want to respond?
Quick clarification, and again, this is a successful track record as well. Over a decade ago, the county board established a self-imposed bonding limitation.
Right.
We have followed that very, very closely, and it's why we have one of the lower amounts of bonding and why we got the kind of good rating report we get from Moody's. We're well below the state-imposed limitations, that's for certain. We have made an exception for the transportation complex. That's why we're above and beyond, as well as the other areas that are in the five-year capital plan. But going forward, you now have further reduced our self-imposed limitation. The Finance Committee recommended to reduce it from $4 million a year, or $8 million every 2 years, to $2.5 million a year. So we have further reduced our own self-bonding limitation, which we intend to follow going forward, unless the board determines that there's a project immense enough, such as the detention center, which the law committee was successful getting in the five-year capital plan, perhaps 5 years out at a cost of $25 million. That would be an opportunity where you probably have to go above and beyond your self-imposed. But we continue to lower that bar, which is, again, why the county board has a good, successful financial track record.
And Supervisor Wegeman, the finance chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do want to point out, we had a $24 million project here that came in under budget. Our plan was to borrow as little as possible and use some general funds. When you look at what we did last year and what we did this year, we borrowed about $14 million for that project. And the rest has been funded by the sale of properties and by coming under budget. So the other monies were for our capital budget last year, about $2.5 million. Now, I would remind the board, we don't always go for bonding every year. We typically bond every other year. So if we're asked, if our capital projects budget is $2.5 million a year, we usually go to market then every 2 years for about $5 million. And that's the intent going forward here. Hopefully we have no other big projects staring us in the face for a while.
Thank you, Supervisor Wegman. Supervisor Hoffman.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I voted for this increase in the bonding limit, and that's because I think the future is bright for Sheboygan County. I believe in Sheboygan County, and I think we're on the right track. We put in all our trucks, so on and so forth, in one central location for maintenance and things like that. Yes, we'll have a couple other sheds, but I think this was the way to go. I know it's expensive, but I think the future's bright. I really believe that. So that's why I voted for this bonding increase.
Thank you, Supervisor Hoffman. Okay, I think you're at the limit of three. This Supervisor Rayner, this is your third one.
Okay, thank you. I'll keep that in mind and try to group them better next time.
Well.
So then, with relationship to the roads are not on the capital plan, and we're anticipating getting, after we reduce the other pieces, we have at least $7 million in tax, so we have an extra $1 million that are not being used for roads. Is that anticipated to just go in our general fund?
You know, that's really not on this bond issue.
Okay, I can appreciate that.
That's another.
I guess I'm looking at it as that $1 million then that would be used for other capital projects, since roads are capital projects.
I'll just say quickly, with the sales tax money, there is money that goes into, we're holding back some money to correct Wendy, if I remember correctly. We have a fund.
To finish my comment, I just don't feel comfortable voting for this piece again. I think I made that clear last year. I said that, you know, unless we have a better picture that we can present as far as what we're, you know, why we continue to have both the sales tax and the added bond amount. mentioned a moment ago, no, we don't have a $10 million per year bond limit. We have an 11, we had an $11 million every 2 years. So there was some misunderstanding with that.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, then we're ready to vote. And I gave you plenty of time, Cheryl, to get it up on the board. So please push your aye or nay button. We'll wait for Supervisor Bemis as he returns.
That motion's approved. 21 aye, 1 nay.
Thank you very much. Okay, ordinance number 8.
Regarding amending section 72.15 and 72.32 of the Sheboygan County Shoreline Ordinance regarding Lake Michigan setback, recommendation to enact.
Supervisor Gehring.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to enact the ordinance.
Thank you, Supervisor Gehring. Supervisor Damp.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will second that endorsement.
Thank you, Supervisor Damp. Any questions or discussion? Seeing no lights, please. No, he wanted to second it. Please push the aye or nay button.
That motion is approved unanimously.
Thank you very much. I'll turn the gavel over to the vice chair.
Resolutions introduced. Resolution number 20 from the Finance Committee.
Regarding amending land records modernization plan.
Resolution number 20 is referred to the Executive Committee. Resolution number 21 from the Planning, Resource, and Ag and Extension Committee.
Regarding approving acquisition of Alliant Utility Corridor property for Rec Trail development.
Resolution number 21 is referred to the Executive Committee. Resolution number 22 from Planning, Resources, Ag and Extension Committee.
Regarding authorizing Sheboygan County Planning and Conservation Department to apply for 2017 County Conservation Aids.
Resolution number 22 is referred to the Finance Committee. Ordinance number 9 from the Transportation Committee.
Regarding establishing speed zones on County Roads J and P, Town of Ryan.
Ordinance number 9 is referred to the Law Committee. Ordinance number 10 from the Transportation Committee.
Regarding adding Sheboygan County Aviation Corporation representative to Airport Advisory Committee.
Ordinance number 10 is referred to the Executive Committee. Next on the agenda, is adjournment. Supervisor Bemis.
I move we adjourn.
Motion is for adjournment. Is there a second? Supervisor Winkle?
Second.
Motion second to adjourn. All in favor, press your aye button. Opposed, press your nay button.
We're adjourned.